and to seek forgiveness and do that which is right. Then only can we see between this you and me the glory of Islam and its endless beauty. No matter where you're from, no matter who you are, when it's time to leave.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to our final episode of Unity, The Way Forward. I'm your host, Junaid Dar, and joining me in the studio is our respected Sheikh, Dr. Haitham Al-Haddad, the Managing Director of Muslim Research and Development Foundation, otherwise known as MRDF, which is based in the UK. And I encourage you to visit the website, Islam21C, and to benefit from the various works that are available there. Sheikh, welcome to the show.
Welcome to you and to all brothers and sisters.
Thank you. In our previous episode, we were discussing manners and etiquettes and how to resolve our differences. And we came to the conclusion that we should return back to the way of the Sahaba because they had differences, but yet it did not enter into their hearts. It did not cause a rift in their brotherhood. So, Sheikh, if we could continue and elaborate on this topic.
Yeah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Ahmaduhu hamd al-shakirin. Wa astaghfiru istighfar al-mudhrimin al-muqassirin. Wa usalli wa usallim ala al-mab'uthi rahmatan lil'alamin. Nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam tasliman kathira. Amma ba'd. I remember that in the previous episode, we started to talk about the story of Ibn Abbas and Zayd ibn Thabit, radiyallahu ta'ala anhum. And we said that they differed on an issue regarding the distribution of inheritance. And this issue, if a person died and he left a grandfather and brothers, who deserves the assets? The grandfather alone or both? The grandfather and the brothers, they share. And Ibn Abbas used to believe that the grandfather deserves everything, and the brothers do not take anything, while Zayd used to believe that they should share the assets of the deceased.
Right.
Ibn Abbas used to say, shouldn't Zayd fear Allah Jalla wa Ala? He considers the grandchildren as children, but he doesn't consider the grandfather as a father.
Right.
So, and one time even, he called him for mubahala. He said, mubahala is a process where the person is invoking the curse of Allah Jalla wa Ala upon himself if he tells lies. To that level. Now, once look at this. How do they use to treat each other? This is what we need to learn in order to establish real unity among ourselves. We cannot suppress differences. We cannot wipe them out, or we cannot brush them under the carpet. No, they are there. We should turn them to a positive,
okay,
attitude or practice that helps us to promote mutual understanding and to benefit the society. So, Ibn Abbas, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, once met Zayd ibn Thabit. Ibn Abbas was very young, and his name is Abdullah ibn Abbas. He is the cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Zayd ibn Thabit is older than him, but he's not of the relatives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they used to meet. Ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he used to take the reins of the camel of Zayd ibn Thabit,
right,
to guide it.
Okay.
Zayd ibn Thabit was amazed. Ibn Abbas, you shouldn't do this. Ibn Abbas used to tell him that, listen, this is the way we should respect our elders and our scholars. And then once Zayd ibn Thabit met Ibn Abbas, he took the hand of Ibn Abbas and kissed it. Ibn Abbas was amazed. What are you doing, ya Zayd? He said, this is the way we should respect the relatives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Subhanallah. Subhanallah.
This is the kind of love that they used to have to each other. Take even more than that. You know, they always say that there were some tension between Aisha and Ali ibn Abi Talib. which is not true. Which is not true. They might have different views, but to say that tension between Ali ibn Abi Talib, the fourth Khalifa, and the most beloved person on earth to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who is Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, that is impossible. Ali ibn Abi Talib used to love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and without a shadow of a doubt, he loves what the Prophet loves. Without a shadow of a doubt. How come I love the Prophet and I, astaghfirullah, does not love his wife? It is impossible. Let alone that Allah Jalla wa Ala says in the Quran, وَأَزْوَاجُهُ, the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أُمَّهَاتُهُمْ, are the mothers of believers.
Right.
So Aisha is the mother of Ali ibn Abi Talib, because she is the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Although Ali ibn Abi Talib might be older than her or of the same age, but she is his mother.
Right.
Now, Aisha once received a person who was asking about wiping over the footwear. She said, I don't have knowledge about this. Go and ask Ali ibn Abi Talib.
Okay.
Now, if she hates him, would she send the person to go to him to ask him? Of course not. Of course not. This is Ali ibn Abi Talib and Muawiyah.
Right.
Okay, let us not talk even about Ali and Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anhum. No, Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu and Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Both of them are companions.
Right.
And Ali, without a shadow of a doubt, is better than Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhum, although we love both of them. And by the way, Muawiyah, many people, especially from certain sects, curse Muawiyah, and we do not accept this under any circumstance. In fact, it was reported that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was asked about Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Sufyan al-Thawri.
Okay.
Sufyan al-Thawri, someone asked him, who is better, Muawiyah or Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiallahu ta'ala anhu? As we said, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz is the fifth Khalifa. He said, are you comparing between a person who saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his eyes have seen the Prophet, with a person who hasn't seen the Prophet? That is Muawiyah. And he is the maternal uncle of believers. Because you know, Muawiyah is the brother of who? Of Umm Habiba, Ramla bint Abi Sufyan,
okay,
the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he said, a piece of hair, a thread of hair in the nozzle of Muawiyah is better than Umar ibn Abdul Aziz.
Subhanallah. It's a very heavy statement.
Very strong statement.
Yes.
Muawiyah, there was like a rift between Muawiyah and Ali ibn Abi Talib during the time of the fitna. When Ali ibn Abi Talib, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, was killed, Muawiyah felt very sad. In fact, there were some reports that he cried. His wife told him, but this is Ali, who you were fighting with him. He said, that was one of the most beloved people to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Don't you want me to cry for him? It was reported that Muawiyah once was sitting, when he became the Khalifa, the established Khalifa. They told him, he saw a person, a friend of Ali ibn Abi Talib. He said, describe Ali ibn Abi Talib. That person started to describe Ali ibn Abi Talib. Muawiyah was crying. They said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, you are crying because of this person. He said, that was one of the most beloved people to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was a very honored person. He was one of the scholars, etc. And he started to praise him. This is between Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu and Muawiyah. Once Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu, so Ammar ibn Talha. You know that there was a kind of tension during the fitna between Ali ibn Abi Talib and Talha.
Okay.
Talha ibn Ubaidillah, he is one of the 10 people granted Jannah.
Right.
And Ali ibn Abi Talib was the first person to be granted Jannah. Talha and Zubair, they fought against Ali ibn Abi Talib in Al-Jamal battle.
Okay.
So Ali ibn Abi Talib shaked hand with the son of Talha, Ammar, and he said to him, I wish that myself and your father will be among the people who will be gathered in Jannah, where Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَنَزَعْنَا مَا فِي صُدُورِهِمْ مِنْ غِلٍّ إِخْوَانًا عَلَى سُرُرٍ مُتَقَابِلِينَ. We have removed the hatred from their hearts, or the enmity from their hearts, إِخْوَانًا عَلَى سُرُرٍ مُتَقَابِلِينَ. Brothers, they meet each other lying on beds in Jannah.
Right.
So this is the way Ali ibn Abi Talib, as some sects say that these are his enemies. This is the way Ali ibn Abi Talib is dealing with so-called his enemies. He used to love them so much. Banu Umayyah, Marwan ibn al-Hakam, when he was fighting with Ali ibn Abi Talib, although Marwan ibn al-Hakam, he was not one of the Sahaba, but one of the Tabi'een. Some scholars considered him one of the scholars of Tabi'een. He said, Rahim Allahu Ali.
Okay.
Rahim Allahu Ali. He used to be an honored person, a dignified person, even during the time of fight, even during the time when we fought against each other. He, one time when we were fighting, he made a declaration that no one should kill a wounded person from the other side.
Okay.
And there were some reports that they used to treat the wounded people from the other camp to this level. This is the kind of love they used to have, the Sahaba, radiyallahu ta'ala anhum, despite the differences they have, despite the fitna that took place between some of them in a certain period of time. That's why it is the principle of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah that we ourselves don't get into the fitna, because Allah forgave all of them. We should not be involved in something that has been finished, and Allah is pleased with all of them.
Okay, and I have to stop you there, Sheikh. Dear viewers, we can see here some beautiful examples from amongst the Sahaba and how they did not let their differences enter into their hearts. And I'm sure that even if we may have differences with one another, that it does not reach that level of fitna or at a war state. But we should forgive one another, we should love one another. And stay tuned, we'll join you in just a few moments.
I think I lost my ablution, but I'm not sure. Do I have to make wudu again? Is it allowed for Muslims to visit the graveyard, or is that shirk? Am I allowed to say Jummah Mubarak to someone? Can I get to know a sister before marriage? I have so many questions, and I feel that I've just reached a dead end. If only I could find someone trustworthy to answer my questions. Someone who speaks based on proof from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back from the break. We're discussing some very interesting, heart-moving stories from amongst the Sahaba. Shaykh, without any further delay, could you return back to these stories?
Yeah, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Of course, we can mention so many of those stories, but this is the last segment of this journey of 13 episodes. May Allah Jalla wa Ala accept it from all of us. In a nutshell, we were saying that the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum are the role model for us. That's why in the ayah of Surah Hud, which we mentioned, وَلَا يَزَالُونَ مُخْتَلِفِينَ إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِبَ رَبُّكَ وَلِذَلِكَ خَلَقَهُمْ. The translation of that, they do not cease, means people. They do not cease but to differ except those whom Allah bestowed His rahmah on. And because of differences, Allah Jalla wa Ala created them. These scholars, they were discussing those whom Allah Jalla wa Ala bestowed His rahmah on. Who are those? And they said, without a shadow of a doubt, they are the companions of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, because they used to differ, but the differences between them has been confined with certain guidelines that make it a positive differences rather than a negative way. And they used to differ and they used to love each other. They used to differ and they used to remain with themselves as brothers. They did not let the differences between themselves go to their hearts.
Right.
And that's why Allah Jalla wa Ala says, لَقَدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ. Allah was pleased with those who have given you the bay'ah تحت الشجرة. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, don't insult or don't curse my sahaba. By Allah, if you spend what is equal to the Jabal, the mountains of Uhud, of gold, you will never be reaching the reward they get when they spend one sa' of gold. So they have a different status. They are the role model for us, in particular in the way they differed.
Right.
So that's why we need to take them as the example. They are our example in their differences. We need to conduct our affairs as they used to conduct our affairs. And this is the message that we need to pass to our brothers and sisters in the last segment of this program.
Can we say that the Sahaba recognized that these differences, as we discussed, are going to remain and they're never going to be resolved? Some issues will never be resolved.
That's right.
So why let that enter into our hearts and cause a rift between you and I?
Exactly. And that's why a person brought a book to Imam Ahmad, and he wrote that this is the book of Khilaf. Imam Ahmad told him, don't call it the book of Khilaf, call it the book of Rahmah, of mercy. The differences can be Rahmah for us, as we mentioned about Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, Rahimahullah. So the message that we want to send to our brothers and sisters, that we cannot move forward as an ummah unless we are united.
Excellent. Okay.
We will never be successful unless we are united. The barakah of Allah Jalla wa Ala, the mercy of Allah Jalla wa Ala, the help and aid of Allah Jalla wa Ala will not be bestowed upon us if we are disunited.
Right.
And Allah Jalla wa Ala, as we mentioned about the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, where he said, Al Jama'atu Rahmah. The Jama'ah, unity, is Rahmah. Allah Jalla wa Ala will give us strength and power when we are united. And He Jalla wa Ala said, and this is a summary of all what we have discussed, and this is the message. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu attaqu allaha haqqa tuqati wa la tamutunna illa wa antum muslimun, and wa'tasimu bihablillahi jami'an wa la tafarraqu. Hold fast all of you together upon the rope of Allah Jalla wa Ala, and don't be disunited. And then Allah Jalla wa Ala said, وَذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ. Remember the favor of Allah Jalla wa Ala upon you when you were enemies, and then Allah Jalla wa Ala joined your hearts together. فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَتِي إِخْوَانًا. And then Allah Jalla wa Ala, let us remember the other ayah. When Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَلَا تَنَازَعُوا, Allah Jalla wa Ala is forbidding us. Forbidding us. From what? From niza'. Niza'a, dispute that leads to what? To disunity.
Right.
What will happen? فَتَفْشَلُوا, you will lose courage. And وَتَذْهَبَ رِيحُكُمْ, your strength departs, leave you. You will not be strong anymore. You will be wiped out. The enemies will overcome you and will take you out. And there will be no deen for Allah Jalla wa Ala in that area where you were disunited and the enemies have taken over you. So it is very important for us as Muslims to be united. The best form of unity is to be united under one leadership. If we can't be united under one leadership, whether we call it caliphate system, whether we call him Khalifa, or we don't call him this, we need to be united under one leadership. If we can't achieve this, let us be united in any other form, if that can be achieved. If we can't be united at this level, at least let us coordinate our strategic opinions. On, as we said in the very early episodes, in terms of strategic matters related to politics and economy.
Okay.
If we can have unified opinions on those matters, then we have achieved a great deal of unity. If we can't do this, at least we should not fight among ourselves.
Right.
This is the minimum. And we say that it is an obligation upon us to seek, obligation upon us as individuals, as scholars, as leaders, to seek unity among the Muslim Ummah, because there is no way forward for us to be a successful nation without unity. And hence, if we can't achieve unity in its full capacity, then we should not fight. And this is the minimum, otherwise we will be so sinful. And then unity, you can say micro unity. This is macro unity.
Right.
Micro unity, where Muslims living as communities or Muslim living as in countries, then they should be united as much as they can. And we spoke about mechanism that promotes unity and love between each other as Muslims is a key fundamental reason behind unity of Muslims wherever they are. So let us not forget love to each other. Let us not forget that we need to manage the differences between ourselves and turn them to a positive phenomena rather than a negative one.
Okay. Sheikh, could we then further elaborate, and just as a kind of conclusion, could we say that unity is actually one of the aims of the Sharia? That
Of course, without a shadow of a doubt. That's why Sheikh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he said, one of the biggest facad, mischief and corruption that have entered on this ummah, to this ummah, is disunity. And then he said, wa unity. He said that this is one of the main and key fundamental principles that Sharia aimed for. من أعظم ما دعت إليه الشريعة.
Right.
He said this is one of the great aims that Sharia called for. And the adilla for this are numerous in Quran and Sunnah. So that aim, we should strive for that aim. We should do our best, all of us, individuals, leaders, groups, organizations, etc. You name it, we need to work hard towards the unity of our ummah, because we know that other aims and objectives of Sharia, such as establishing the deen of Allah Jalla wa Ala on this globe, cannot be achieved without unity. In fact, protecting our lives as Muslims, or honored lives as human beings, and protecting the dignity of human beings, the intellect of human beings, the wealth of human beings, the honor of human beings cannot be achieved if Muslims are disunited, because if Muslims are disunited, then they will not be the leaders of the globe of other nations. And right. if Muslims fail to be the leaders of all nations, other nations that take their guidance from biased people, they take their guidance from other than Allah, will be the leaders. And then the whole world, the whole globe will suffer, because we have taken and abandoned the leadership of the world and gave it to other than the light of Allah Jalla wa Ala.
Excellent. Beautiful. Unfortunately, we have come to the end of this series, this beautiful series. I hope that we have extracted so many points of benefit. Unity, the way forward. We must understand that we must unite on a political level, we must unite on an economic level, and we must unite on a local level. Unity is our success in this world. Unity is our success in the hereafter. Take that as the last point, and we hope to see you in another program. Until then, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
It's time to seek forgiveness and do that which is right.